What is going on, comic fam? It's your boy, the Bearded Comic Bro, and I am joined by comic creator James Roche. Welcome to the show, man.
What's going on, man? Appreciate it.
I am so excited. You are the creator behind one of the comics that I adored during this last year, 2020, Wretches from Scout Comics. It's fantastic. It's awesome. So I want to talk about that. I want to talk about just any other projects you got going on and stuff like that. But before we do, I always like to open up my interview with, how did you get into, do you read comics? Or have you always been a reader of comics? How did you get into liking comics?
So I read comics as a kid. And then, you know what? I don't know what happened, you know, life. I mean, I used to be a huge gamer. I have three kids now, so I can't play anything anymore. I've been out of the loop. Pop culture, like things that have happened the last 8 years since I had my daughter, 9 years. Wow. All that stuff is kind of gone by the wayside. But yeah, so from reading comics as a kid, playing video games, anime, like watching cartoons, all that good stuff, I kind of put comics down, I think maybe in high school. And I got back into it with, I think it might have been Lock and Key, I think was the first kind of series that really brought me back into it. That, and I think it's, I Kill Giants was another big one that kind of touched me personally. Yeah. So that made, that tugged at my heartstrings and really like pulled me back into reading comics.
Yeah. That's awesome. Yeah. I feel like there's always, whenever I do these questions, there always seems to be like a, there's this period of drop off for us. Cause like, it's the same for my story. I'm like, yeah, somewhere between high school and then like 10 years after high school, like I finally got back into comics. And so like, I feel like it happens for a lot of us. So
yeah, totally. I think I've talked to people about the same thing, and you know, whatever it is, maybe teenage boys, you know, I don't know if right. You played sports. I mean, I played a little bit of basketball. But yeah, I think I was playing a lot of Counter-Strike and Warcraft before World of Warcraft. I was playing like the StarCraft, Warcraft, the strategy game, like yeah. LAN connections, or we used to go to an internet cafe. I grew up in New York and we used to go after school. We'd walk down to this internet cafe and it'd be loaded with 20, 30 computers. We'd be all playing Counter-Strike in the same room, you know, yelling, just people smoking back in the days, so the cigarettes, like it's just chaotic, you know.
It sounds fantastic. But
yeah, that kind of took me away from from comics. That was fun in and of itself.
Yeah, different hobbies. I mean, that's the thing. Like you said, sports. Like, yeah, I mean, I was wrestling, and so high school, college, that took me out of it. And it definitely is a, because I mean, getting back into reading comics, like it's a job that you gotta love, because there's a lot of good stuff out there, and it can be all consuming.
Oh, totally. Especially, I mean, I don't read as much mainstream. I read a lot of indie is mostly all I do, especially via Kickstarter. You know, I'll support different small press publishers, but Kickstarter, crowdfunding, I mean, I find like most of the comics I buy are indies on Kickstarter.
Yeah.
But getting into, if you wanted to pick up today and jump into mainstream, I mean, you know, I know some things that are going on with the mainstream titles, but it can be daunting.
It is. But I think that's, you make a great point, because I feel like the conversation always comes up, like, how do you get people into comics? And people always will say, like, don't go the mainstream, go indie, because there's so much more opportunity, I think, for unique storytelling. Mm-hmm. And that opens it up. So I completely understand your like of, man, if I'm reading comics, that's what I'm reading. Cause that seems to be a majority of my pull list these days are indie books, or like you said, Kickstarters. I mean, I never backed a Kickstarter until 2020. And then I'm like looking at my Kickstarter list. I'm like,
wow, you're all in.
I am.
No, that's awesome, man.
So, well, then what was the shift then for you to go from enjoying comics, getting back into comics, to then saying, you know what, I want to start to write comics?
I wanted to, I don't know, I kind of talk about this on my show and with different interviews that I do, like, where does the seed of storytelling kind of get planted, or where does that come from? And to me, I mean, I think it's got to come from being a kid. Like, I used to play with G.I. Joes, not the 4-inch G.I. Joes, not the big boys, the old school ones, but I used to play with them, maybe 20 or 30 of them, and have a intricate setup, like crazy storylines, and do that day after day after day. So the storytelling, I think, for me, a big fly in here. I don't know if you saw that thing.
I didn't.
Also, it was there.
I'll put a fly in post, so we'll make sure you're not
crazy. I don't look as crazy as I am. But But yeah, so the storytelling seed, I think, got planted then. And I feel like in my late teens or maybe early 20s, I moved to New Jersey from Brooklyn. And when I came out here after high school, I didn't like know that many people. I didn't have a lot of friends. So I think I would leave the house just to go to like a day job, like delivering pizza or something. And I'd come home and I think I would write. I would just write, watch movies, play video games, and I would write. And I started wanting to write short stories. And I ended up going to school for animation and graphic design. So I was doing animation for a little while, and I wanted to pursue doing short, you know, animated, not features, but just short animated things, videos, and build the storytelling that way.
Yeah.
So that kind of fell off a little bit, you know, life happens, and, you know, I went down a different path or a different fork in the road, but that's kind of how the storytelling, started. And then I started writing this short story that turned into my first, I did a Kickstarter maybe in 2015 for, and it was a graphic novel at the time, so it was like 150 plus pages. I probably raised $100 out of the $10,000 goal that I wanted. I did no, there was no social media game I had going on. I had nothing. I made all the fatal mistakes. And so, you know, I learned that lesson pretty hard, but that was my first, that was the first thing I wrote. I think that was the first comic I wrote. It's called The Stoned Ape Society. Nice. It was based off of this stoned ape hypothesis.
Yeah.
Which is, I don't know if you've heard of that. That's someone theorized, I forget who it was. He theorized that, I think before Neanderthals, I think the, you know, or whatever it was, the monkeys came in Africa, they came down off the trees, and it sparked the evolution by flipping cow patties, eating magic mushrooms. And that sparked evolution. So I kind of took that as, you know, they built a society, and it was kind of, it was chaotic, but, you know,
nice.
Learning curve in my first step into writing a long story.
So my first exposure, that's so cool, by the way, I guess you're like, I love hearing the origin stories. Well, my first exposure to you, like I said, was reading Wretches. And so how did you get that book to Scout, and how did that kind of idea come about with that?
That kind of, so I'll segue. So I was writing, when I wrote that long epic graphic novel that ended up, I did 60 pages and it went nowhere. I learned, you know what, I got to start smaller. So I started writing a few short comics. You know, I think I took advice that I might have read on Tumblr at the time for maybe, I think it was like Brian Michael Bendis or a lot of the pros at that time started saying start small. And New York Comic Con, like going to panels that people would recommend, start small, just get something done. You know, once you could hold it in your hands, you go through the motions and the different, you know, collaborations that you have to have. So you learn all that stuff. So I wrote a sci-fi short comic, which was actually acted as a prologue. It had the two main characters, Shay and Sean, in it. It featured them. It was probably an eight page comic. And I ended up pitching it to, I think Alterna at the time was doing their If anthology, which was a collection of short, it was an anthology, different themes. This one happened to be sci-fi. I had this short comic that I had finished maybe a couple months back. I pitched it to them. They picked it up. And I'll tell you, the feeling of getting your first, your first like stamp of approval, you know, somebody liking what you're doing. It's that fueled me. You know, to this day, I still get, you know, I get good vibes from that. I remember that feeling. So that kind of got me into the world of Wretches. And I thought, you know what, I'm going to take these two characters. They fled their home planet. This is their origin story. I'm going to put that to the side, but I'm going to continue the story. I'm going to pick it up when they're older, how their life turned out on this, this alien planet and this whole different solar system. And that's kind of where it started. So with Scout, you know what? I took issue one and issue two to Kickstarter.
Okay.
And I funded them both on Kickstarter. I think I had met or I'd spoken with James Hake, one of the Scout, I think he's the president now.
Yeah.
And one of their founding fathers, I believe. So I'd known him back then, but I pitched a different title to Scout and they liked it, but they didn't, it wasn't for them. And I think one of the gentlemen at the time said, you know, if you have anything else, pitch it to us. And I had Wretches. I was finished with issue two.
Yeah.
So I said, you know what? I have something for you. Here's two issues of this finished book or this work in progress. And they loved it and they picked it up. And yeah, the rest is history.
That's awesome. That's so cool. Yeah. so many Scott's just doing so many cool things, and I've had a lot of their creators on and stuff like that. So when finally having you on the show has been super exciting, because this literally was one of the first books that I found out about Scout Comics through.
Oh wow.
So, yeah, like, cool, man. That's
awesome. So
I love it. It's all
uphill from there.
It is. So is this, if someone's not familiar with this story, real quick, what's the elevator pitch if for some reason people haven't gotten to pick up Wretches yet?
Man, well, Wretches, the trade is out. I mean, the trade came out, I think, last July. But the elevator pitch, I mean, it's really a story about family. It's a brother and sister. One of them gets taken. The other one's going to stop at nothing to tear the galaxy up until they can get them back. We have sentient robots. But I think the heart and the heart of the story is definitely the family. You know, that's kind of the underlying theme is loss and dealing with loss, something that everyone's been experienced. And the artist Solomon Farias and the colorist Chunlin Zhao, their style art brings it. I mean, it's just awesome. It's like a Blade Runner, cyberpunk meets the Fifth Element. You know, wild action, fun. That was a good one. It was awesome. It was a lot of fun doing. As many years in the making. And yeah, that was probably the highlight of my 2020.
Nice. You said Fifth Element. I just wanted to shout Multipass real quick.
Yes, Multipass. Love them. Love Super that. Green.
It's so good. It's such a good movie. Well,
yeah.
I want to talk more about, you know, some of the other stuff that you're creating and writing. But first, you mentioned just a little bit ago about your own show. You have a YouTube channel where you have a show called Writing Comics and website about that as well. What's your YouTube channel then? Because I don't have too many comic creators come on my show that have YouTube channels, so like, yeah. I'm super excited to like to spread the news of this.
No, I appreciate it, man. Thanks for having me on to even talk about it. So yeah it's been, you know, a couple of years ago I wanted to put a YouTube channel together where I just, it's a few different things, there's different segments. There's the writing comics where I kind of talk about how I write comics, not really a how-to, because there's no one way to do it. I just talk about how I do it. And that's very involved. The few that I've done so far, it's been, you know, brainstorming, which leads to the outlining, which leads to writing the script. And, you know, I try to throw up examples and have them cut in and out pretty well. You know, it's time consuming, but I wanted early on to have, I guess, kind of like a resource for newer creators, something that I didn't have, at least via YouTube when I was starting out. So I have that, the writing comic side, like I said, where I go through my motions. And then I have the other segment's called Comic Book Writers on Writing. And I interview other comic book writers, surprise, surprise. And yeah, I talk about their process, their experiences in the industry, the business side. So I talked to James Hake a while back, that episode just went up, and he talks about pitching to Scout, you know, the must-haves for pitching. He talks about the involvement of pitching IP to multimedia, you know, companies, production companies for TV and film. He gets into that. He talks about how they allow, you know, creators to utilize Kickstarter and still publish with them in the direct market,
right?
Which is kind of a trend setting a little bit, in my opinion. I've got, I think, Gamal Hennessy's coming on. He wrote he's a lawyer. So he is, oh man, I don't have it in front of me. I'm not prepared, but he kickstarted a book, and he's a thick book on how to publish and self-publish your own comics as an independent creator. Nice. So we talked about contracts. We talked about, for an hour, we went into, you know, what to look for, the do's, the don'ts. And so it's just been fun. It's kind of been a way for me to aggregate different types of info, you know, especially coming from the writer's side, the different types of info that, you know, one might need or want to know or be looking for when you just start out.
Yeah, it's such a cool concept. Like, I mean, you get a lot of, you know, I do creator interviews. I know a lot of other YouTube channels do creator interviews, you know, as we're trying to, like, you know, fill the gap here between Comic Cons of, you know, getting to have that experience a little bit. But I love the kind of, like you said, not as so much a how-to panel, but more of like, how do you do it? Or how does Scout look at receiving pitches, and what do they look for? And those are like, I think that's such a cool concept to see, like, the behind the scenes, because there are a lot of people out there that are, you know, doing Kickstarters, that are writing comics, that are doing artwork for comics, that I think are just trying to like crowdsource themselves and just try and figure out like, what do I do? And I think it's such a cool concept to see like, hey, I'm sharing my knowledge of what I know. And like you said, it's not how to do it, it's how I do it. So take it as you will. But I think it's a unique take on a channel that, like I said, I've been reading your stuff, and I just found the channel as I was doing research to talk to you today. I'm like, wait a second, how did I miss this?
I need it. That's going to be the next episode, how to promote yourself better. Which it's a learning process for me as well. You know, I learn from every guest. I learn a little bit, and I take things away. And that's part of it too. I want to have these conversations, like you said, in between conventions. I want to continue having them and growing and learning different things. So yeah, it's been a lot of fun.
Yeah.
It's my handle. Well, it's James E. Roche, Roche. That's my YouTube channel, but you could type in writingcomics.net. That'll get you right to the YouTube channel, the main page. And yeah, man.
Yeah. And if you're watching this or listening to this on the podcast, any link that we mention will be in the video description here below. So Instagram handles, Twitter handles, websites, YouTube channel, all that stuff will be listed below. So make sure you guys take some time after this interview to go click on those and subscribe all across the board on all platforms.
Nice.
Where did this kind of idea though for you of like, hey, I want to take something different. I want to look at, you know, like the behind the scenes of comics a little bit and share that knowledge. How did you kind of like, where was that point for you? Like, this is what I want to do.
I think, you know what? I watch a lot of YouTube, or even I used to work in the city, and I still have the same job, but I don't commute anymore to New York City from New Jersey. It's an hour and change, you know, the commute. So I would put YouTube on and, you know, be able to turn it off, or I'd watch it when I'm commuting and walking across town in Manhattan, and listen to various things, podcasts, short clips of this, that, and the other thing. But one of the things I love listening to is just creators talk about creating. And it doesn't even have to be comics. It could be, I follow a lot of like film channels and they'll post a lot of behind the scenes things with, you know, the director of the film, or I'm drawing a blank on what the company is or the channel is, but they'll get, you know, five directors in a room, and one guy will, they'll be the host, and he'll just bounce the conversation around. They'll talk about their craft, and just like being a fly on the wall and hearing that sort of thing, it's just inspiring. You know, I love it. And I thought that's kind of the inspiration behind it. Yeah. I wanted to have those conversations, be a part of them, and bring it to the comic book writing, something that I do, and bring it to that world. And just, yeah, that's kind of where it came about.
Yeah. Getting the kind of, you hit it right on the nail for me. Like, you know, like getting to hear how people create things and what inspires them. One of my favorite podcasts that I listen to is not even comic book related. It's How I Built This, by Guy Raz. I can't ever say his name.
Okay.
NPR, but he literally interviews people like, you know, the, you know, whoever created the Kind Bar, you know, or the Clif Bar, you know, who created like legging, like all the, like just random brands, you know, the guy who did the Power Rangers and brought it over, like all these different people, just kind of like the, how did you get this kind of process going? And it's so interesting to just hear people's origin stories when it comes especially to their passions of, and right, bringing it to people. And I think that's a really cool thing. What you're doing is getting to go deeper into something that we as nerds love of comics and pop culture and stuff. But getting to just kind of see like, you know, it's almost like the behind the scenes for us, like the, you know, watching the film with the director commentary on it.
It's a good way to say it.
But getting to see like, and then also like, I know I have people that watch and follow my channel that are, you know, aspiring comic creators too, to just say like, you know, what are ways that I might be able to get my foot in the door of what's a process that I should, you know, attempt? Am I doing it completely wrong? Because like you said, it's a learning process. You talked about Kickstarter, your first one, 120, and then you had two successful, you know, ones with Wretches. I think people are wanting that information. I think so. If you have the ability to share that, I think that's awesome.
Right. No, thank you. And you know, a lot of it is, I think I said it in one of the videos, I screwed it up enough times to be able to say, all right, this is what I did. These are my approaches.
Yeah.
Bring on some other writers. These are their approaches, their experiences. As a listener or a watcher, take what you find or what you think might be useful to you and ditch the rest. Take it in from other sources, other, you know, instructional videos or whatever, wherever you want to get the info from, but mold it to something that, you know, you can use and something that'll work for you. There's no blueprint.
It's a great idea and a great concept. I just discovered it this week. So I'm like, I'm so excited to unpack it even more. So let's talk a little bit more comics. I know I jumped off Wretches real quick, but do you, are you wrapped up with that story? Do you have visions for more, or is it kind of a holding pattern?
I do have vision. It's a little bit of a holding pattern slash visions for more. I have ideas and stuff that I would like to get to. There are other things that I don't want to say cut the line, but I want to complete a few other projects, a few other stories before I just, because I can see myself getting lost in Wretches and then just that'll be it, you know, but I want to play in different genres, different. Yeah. So something I'm working on now, it's going to be published. Can't say the publisher, but it's going to be published either late 2021 or early 2022. I've been working with an artist for a while who actually got pulled off. So I think we successfully pitched it in 2017 maybe 2018, but he got pulled off to do some work with Cartoon Network. So I had to rightfully so. I said, no problem, man. You gotta, you know, do your thing. So we brought it back. We're starting to work on it now. It is Dr. Seuss meets Sin City. And if you follow any of my stuff, I think it's on my website. I posted little bits here and there the last couple of years. But it is equipped with like rhyming narrative. It's got the pentameter. It's all Dr. Seuss style. The art is there, but the grittiness is that of a Sin City, of a crime noir. You know, the damsel, the crooked boss, the undercover detective who gets in too deep. You know, there's a lot. I can't wait for that. It's being colored right now, and then I'm gonna have to do the second pass on the script, like the lettering phase, to get the dialogue and the captions and the narrative down right. But man, it's that one. I just love. It's my excuse to write rhymes, probably, or to be a quasi rapper too. But it's a children's book, crime noir genre mashup. I'm looking forward to that one.
Like, it's one of those things where you say something where you hear something you didn't know you needed in your life, but then as soon as you hear it, I'm like, holy cow, I need a Dr. Seuss Sin City matchup in my life. Like, that sounds fantastic. And like, I want to be in the room when you have pitched that to people, like, hey, here, I got an idea. Sin City, Dr. Seuss.
That's a quick, good one-liner for a pitch. You know, I've had a few people like bite on that or say they loved it.
Yeah.
But yeah, that kind of got it in the door. That one line, Dr. Seuss meets Sin City. I mean, you don't really have to get too much more detail. If you have 5 seconds to pitch it, like that's the line. But yeah, man, I'm looking forward to it.
Dude, that's awesome.
I'll send you some stuff.
That'd be great. That's so exciting. So yeah, well, it makes sense on why you want to, you know, like, because it's Wretches is something you're comfortable with. It's a world you've created and you're known to, but you want to be able to explore other things as well. And thank goodness you do, because now we are getting this Dr. Seuss meets Sin City.
Oh yeah. Yeah. I have a children's book. I want to say a young adult. It's kind of an all ages book, really. I'm working on that with another familiar publisher that we might've brought up a couple of times, but that hasn't been announced yet. And that's a late to mid 2022 thing.
Okay.
So I'm totally looking forward to that. That's kind of like a Harry Potter meets Lord of the Rings with a little bit of like the never ending story in there. And I'm totally looking forward to that one too.
Yes. So let's dig in real quick, if you don't mind. And I'm sure you probably tease us a little bit. And I know I asked with Wretches, where does this process for you when you get an idea? Like, does it come over, you know, are you one of those, like, you get it that night, like, and you just write it down? Or is it kind of like an idea that percolates that you like sit on for weeks on end and process it more, like even like the Dr. Seuss Sin City, you know, like, where do these ideas come from? Like, how quick of a process is it? Is it short, or is it a really long drawn out process when you're kind of thinking, what do you want to put to paper?
It is definitely a long process. I'm trying to think that one in particular where it came from. And I think it came from reading an anthology, a crime comic book anthology. I think I read somebody else's story that inspired me. They were telling a crime story, but it was like I think it was Kick-Ass. I think it was Mark Millar did a short story competition for like Millar World.
Yeah.
And you could pitch a short story for a number of their titles. And somebody did a story for Kick-Ass with a Hit Girl. And it was it Big Daddy was teaching her how to fight, but also teaching her, not the ABCs, but something to the effect, there was studying involved.
Yes. So
it was like A is for ass kicking, B is for beat up, or whatever. They went through A to Z.
Yeah.
And I don't think it rhymed, but it was kind of a children's book meets Kick-Ass.
Right.
And I thought, man, that's pretty cool. And then I guess the wheel started turning there. And I thought, if I was going to do that, I would have made it rhyme. Like I want to tell a child, you know, then Dr. Seuss started tricking or hitting off in the back of my head. And I used to freestyle a while back, like when I first moved out to New Jersey, I freestyled. I think it helped me reminisce about living in Brooklyn, but it helped me pass the time when I first moved out here. So I think that played a factor in it. And so how did that come about? I mean, after that, when I brainstorm, I'm looking around for books. I mean, especially when I was commuting, I'd have a different book each day, or, you know, I have a notebook here, yeah, another notebook here, different sizes. I have those marble, you know, composition notebooks, maybe in my backpack. So I'll just write different, you know, brainstorming notes. It could be a log line. It could be the ending. It could be some dialogue, some banter, an action scene in the middle of the book. But these little things, I'll put them like puzzle pieces. I'll just brainstorm
yeah,
until I think it's worth exploring and, you know, making a book. Then I'll outline and kind of, you know, take all those little puzzle pieces and start formulating them a little bit better. But it's definitely a long process, man.
Dude, that's so cool. Like, I wish I could beatbox so I could have you freestyle.
Oh, yeah. It's been a while.
But
I wouldn't do it. I wouldn't do it live.
But the kind of, like you said, like to see the process of what it, you know, like what reminisce, like what kicks it off for you for an idea. That's so cool to see that behind the scenes a little bit. So you've got the Dr. Seuss and City, you've got the all ages book coming out in a year or two, it sounds like.
Comics take Potter, time.
Lord of the Rings, all that jazz. Are those kind of your main focuses right now? Do you got more stuff mm-hmm. percolating right now?
Yeah. Or? I mean, the channel has been taking a lot of, as you know, these take time and you edit yours and posts. So I do that. I've been having good luck, at least with the like Instagram reels and even TikTok for those short hitters, you know, like a quick, whatever we're talking about a topic, if we nail it in like 30 seconds, when I look at things in post, I cut them up and I put them on there. So that takes time, but it's well worth it. You know, it brings eyes to the show and the different creators. So I just got a huge chunk of my time, but yeah, each of the other two titles, they're still not complete. There's still works in progress. Right. Art's being done for both of them while, you know, I'm writing bits and pieces of it here and there. They're all in different phases, but I also just pitched I'll say it here. I pitched a manga to a big publishing company. They are the Viz Media, and they are publishing, or they're looking, and they opened the door to, I think, like Western manga.
Okay.
And Western creators.
Yeah.
So I pitched something to them with artist Paul Gorey a little bit, maybe a couple of weeks ago. That my fingers are crossed on that, because that would be awesome. That's a fun like sci-fi story. It's called Multiverses, and it's kind of I don't know if you remember the movie The One with Jet Li, which is kind of a blend of Highlander, right? You kill your alternate double in another universe, you get their powers. That's kind of the gist of the story. There's a queen, there's a female general on one advanced civilization that finds out how to travel through the multiverse. And she's kind of disgruntled. She's not getting the respect she deserves. So on one planet, she kills herself and finds that she gets her power, her intelligence, her wisdom. So she secretly starts doing this, you know, across the multiverse. So she's a villain. She's the antagonist. And then we go to our Earth, and you have this meek like pizza delivery driver named Ron Zelch. And he loves the girl. The woman he loves is the alternate version of this queen woman who sends like her hitmen after her. So he kind of gets thrown into the multiverse, kind of trying to go after her and save her. And his alternate comes, who typically kills him to get his power and then go take down the queen. he comes in, he kind of saves him, and they form like a buddy cop, like a Lethal Weapon type deal to go save the girl and bring down the queen. So that's the whole quick elevator pitch for that manga that I'm hoping, man, that's going to be a wild one.
I'm on the edge of my seat, just like, okay, keep going. What else? What happens next?
Well, like, what I love about that, I could jump from, I mean, once you have, you know, the multiverse involved, like one of the characters was an alternate of another one of the Earth characters. He looks like Ghost Rider. And then another one of him looks like, he's like a squid, you know, a human bipedal squid. So we're going to go to different planets, you know, a water world planet, a frozen planet, a primitive planet where dinosaurs rule and they talk. You know, the sky's the limit with what we can do. So if they pick it up, man, I hope we can make something happen. If they don't, you know, we can go to a Kickstarter and try and bring it to life either way.
Dude, that sounds fantastic. Well, like,
thank you.
You have so many irons in the fire with your comics and YouTube, because I know creating content, just how time consuming that is. So like, and then like on top of like, oh, you're creating YouTube content, but you're also writing comics, stuff that I utilize for my YouTube content.
Yeah.
So I'm like, man, you are grinding and I appreciate it.
Yeah, yeah. No, thank you, man. And same here. I appreciate the hustle and drive when I see it in other people. Definitely see it with what you're doing. And yeah, man, it's a grind.
Yeah.
I love it.
It is. Well, I hesitate to ask you any like what else you got going, because I know you seem like you got I don't want to take up too much of your time. Is there anything else that we haven't gotten to touch on that you want to just hit real quick?
No, I think we wrung the towel dry.
We did.
All I got. Everything I'll work it out.
Everything. So anything.
Oh, I did just find out today. I got accepted. I'm going to have a table at New York Comic Con in October. So as long as, you know, everything's are going good.
Yeah.
I don't know if you're, I think you're from Ohio, right?
Yep. Yep. So
okay. If you happen to make your way in October to New York or anybody on the East Coast, yeah, I will be there. Come say hi.
I know I definitely have some creators that watch and support my stuff that are closer East Coast. So for sure on that. But yeah, I'm so excited. We're hitting up some cons. We've got our Washington Comic Con in September that we're going down to Kentucky to do that. And
awesome,
man, it's my wife and I, like, that was our thing. Like, we always had Comic Cons. And so like, man, it's been almost a year and a half
that over, I feel like, yeah, we right? over a like, year
like our last one was in November of like 2019, and I'm like, oh man, I can't wait.
Yeah, no, I think me too. I think that was when I think I was there, and I'll make this quick. I think I tore my Achilles, I think it was mid 2019, so I had to get out to New York Comic Con. I was kind of healed, I was limping around in a boot, but they Scout put out a New York Comic Con issue one for Wretches before it released in stores, I think February.
Okay.
So they put it out early, and yeah, I was behind, they let me sit behind the booth because my foot was swelling up. I needed to rest. They were like, come back here. I was signing copies. It was fun. But yeah, that was my last hoorah, my last convention too.
Oh man. So, and you said you got some new creators coming onto the channel real quick for yours. So that's exciting. Gang, like I said, everything that we've talked about is in the description of this video. If you are not following James on YouTube, James E. Roche, check it out. Such a cool concept, what you're doing. It's a unique take on what a lot of us as creators consume that I think you guys will not be disappointed. If you like comics, check that out for sure. And go pick up the Trade of Wretches if you haven't, for some reason. Like, what are you doing with your life? Because it's fantastic and I love it.
Fifth Element, sci-fi, action, adventure. Yes. That's cool, man. It was a fun one. I appreciate it, buddy.
Yeah, I do too. What's the best way for people? I know, like you've said, like you're across all platforms, but if people want to stay in contact, like what is your most active? Like, where's the best way for them to follow what you're doing?
James E. Roche on pretty much every social media handle. It's Roche. So jamesEroche.com. And yes, at James E. Roche on every handle. Instagram has kind of been my like kind of favorite thing as a creator and putting out content as of late. So yeah, definitely check me out there. You could DM me, shoot me an email.
Awesome. Awesome. Well, thank you so much for taking some time. I expect to have you back on with some other content here
soon. Yes.
and talk and
totally
and see what else we can put together. But man, James, thank you so much for just taking some time out of your busy schedule to just sit down and talk about comics and YouTube with me. I appreciate it.
Thank you, man. Thank you very much. I appreciate it.
Gang, go sub up, James. And with that being said, hopefully you can find some time to curl up, grab a book, and nerd out. Peace.